everyone. So I'm here with my November wrap-up. I read 9 books during nonfiction November. So I will try to make this as speedy as possible, starting with the first book. The first book I finished was 84 Charing Cross Road by Helene Hanff. I actually thought that this was a fictional work, but it's actually a compilation of the American author's correspondence to a bookseller in London from 1949 to 1968. The brief collection is heartwarming and illustrative of how storytelling and literature binds people, even if they're separated by location and culture. The bookseller in London, Frank Dole, is dry-humored and adept at sourcing the academic texts Helene requests during the fixation on obscure British classics. Helene proves herself a humorist match to Frank's wit. This book is a real comfort and naturally a fit for fans of another epistolary work, though it's fiction, The Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society by Marianne Schaefer and Annie Barrows. Then I read A Journal of a Solitude by May Sarton. This is May Sarton's diary entries that were compiled and published in 1973. This book was particularly fascinating to me since Sarton was writing these entries while living in northern New Hampshire, about an hour from where I'm currently located. In these diary entries, she catalogs her daily rhythms, writing, hosting friends, rather reluctantly curating her garden, and complaining about struggling to heat up her house in the New England winter. Sarton captures the contradictions of wanting alone time but not wanting to be lonely. I thought this book was slow and sleepy, but her observations as an introvert particularly are quite relatable. I did want to read one small section that I love. I have time to think, that is the greatest luxury. I have time to be, therefore my responsibility is huge, to use time well and to be all that I can, whatever years are left to me. Next, I read In the Garden, Essays on Nature and Growing by a variety of different authors, including Jamaica Kincaid, Nigel Slater, and Daisy LaFarge. The personal essays meditate on the restorative powers of sustaining living things, but the meaning of the collection as a whole is quite political. The central focus is accessibility, and there's an underpinning argument that green spaces should be open to everyone from all backgrounds. Francesca Wade writes about a column that was published in 1944 where George Orwell notes that the railings removed for scrap metal during the Second World War was really a democratic gesture. His suggestion being that gardens should be public in perpetuity. Quoted from that column, "For 3 years or so, the squares lay open and their sacred turf was trodden by the feet of working class children. A sight to make dividend drawers gnash their false teeth. If that is theft, all I can say is so much the better for theft." Which I thought was just absolutely stunning. The collection is wild gardening in words. It's nurturing and encompasses anyone who wants to partake in caring for the natural world and appreciating its beauty. Then I absolutely devoured Eat Up, Food, Appetite, and Eating What You Want by the British Bake Off alumna Ruby Tandoh. In a collection of essays and food-related anecdotes and recipes, Ruby redirects our insecurities around consumption and our hyperfixation on curbing our appetites for the sake of false societal ideals. She focuses on how food isn't only necessary to survive, but it's a key element in experiencing joy and improving our quality of life. I actually made her simple comfort tomato soup. This is a recipe that she includes in the book. It only requires a can of tinned tomatoes, like a glug of olive oil, water or broth, and crushed basil. I would highly recommend the soup and the book. And the next book that I read this November, I've already talked about in the classics book tag, and that book is The Well of Loneliness by Radclyffe Hall. I will link that video down below. Suffice to say, I enjoyed it. Next, I finally picked up the winner of this year's Orwell Prize, which is Small Things Like These by Claire Keegan. I knew this book took place in a small Irish town during the Christmas season, so it felt like the right time of year to crack it open, finally. The story takes place in 1985 and follows Bill Furlong, who is a coal merchant who works relentlessly to support his wife and his five daughters. He is an illegitimate son of a woman who gave birth to him out of wedlock while working in service. He confronts his personal history when he discovers the industry behind the local convent and the town's complicity in the nuns' abuse of young, unwed women and mothers used for free labor to run a laundry service as penance for their so-called sins. I have heard criticisms from fellow booktubers about the author's choice to detail the conditions of a Magdalene laundries via a male perspective. I partially agree. However, I wonder if this choice is meant to draw attention to the idea of redirecting blame and men removing themselves from a moral judgment that is left mostly reserved for women. Bill Furlong puts himself in the position of the women in the laundry using his relationship with his late mother as a once unwed woman. Then again, this book isn't long enough and doesn't flesh out Bill's reflections, so it feels like an unfinished work. The choice to tell the story through Bill feels like the female characters end up becoming plot devices, so I feel like this book could have been more, but what we did get is foundationally good, though it definitely needs a few more chapters, I think, to get something of real substance across. I would suggest a more involved book on the topic called The Lost Child of Philomena Lee, A Mother, Her Son, and a 50-Year Search by Martin Sixsmith. This is about Philomena Lee's experience in a convent in Ross Cray in County Tipperary. So then I branched off from my usual genres and decided to read Nina Mingya Powell's debut poetry collection, Magnolia. Nina calls back to childhood identity markers like the realization of Mulan's gender bending. I've read Nina's Tiny Moons and some of her short form writing, and she is fantastic at expressing her unbelonging as a mixed-race woman who calls New Zealand home, who shares a Malaysian culture with her mother but is perceived as a white woman by people who do not know her. Nina's poetry is approachable, concise, yet impactful all at the same time. And next, I was so excited to finally read Sanitorium by Abi Palmer on Scribd. Abi Palmer is sardonic in her tracing of hopelessness and brief moments of reprieve from chronic pain. So in this book, Abi received a grant that allowed her to document her pain management and rehabilitation while enlisting in a recovery regime in the sulfur baths of Budapest. She attempts to prolong this experience by purchasing a bloat pool in her London flat, only to fixate on ways that this method is not conducive to suburban living, functional suburban living. The descriptions of Abby's hallucinations and disassociations from a body in intense pain are tangible and disturbing. Doctors either excuse her symptoms as anxiety or encourage her to push her body beyond its limits, mostly to rid her of her need for a wheelchair, since they see the use of a wheelchair as a sign of weakness or a symbol of difference rather than a tool. Sanitorium is a brilliant mix of scribbled diary entries and images of the mobility exercises that she had to complete while she was visiting the sulfur baths in Budapest. The book is frustrating, but also comforting for anyone else who has experienced medical gaslighting or is on a desperate chase for physical and mental relief. And finally, I stretched my brain with Daisy Hildyard's philosophical essay, The Second Body. This is a succinct argument for environmental and self-awareness. At the center of the argument is that every living being possesses two bodies, a physical body that eats, sleeps, functions, etc., and one that is integrated in the ecosystem at large. You breathe in as the first body and breathe out CO2 in the second body. Essentially, Daisy posits that the first body denies the existence of the second, which is how we are able to deny the frightening rising sea levels, the rapid occurrence of forest fires, and climate disasters while running our banal errands every day. There's a disconnect between the two bodies. Throughout the course of the work, Daisy interviews disparate people to gather an idea of how individuals perceive their second body. She meets a Yorkshire butcher. She interviews an environmental criminologist, a biologist, someone who studies fungi. And she concludes that there are here and now people and those whose boundary between the first and second body are more dissolved. Therefore, they have more of an awareness of their impact on the world. The book is definitely a complicated read, but digestible with enough reflection. All in all, a fantastic nonfiction November. Next video coming out will be the first in a handful of Vlogmas videos. I'm super excited for you guys to join in decorating our Christmas tree. If you haven't already, please like and subscribe and share with your book reading pals. I post every Wednesday and Saturday, and I will see you very soon. Bye!